And the sadness that I feel sometimes is, did I fully appreciate that moment while it was happening? Or was I so obsessed with all of the different things that weren't going quite right? If you're investing in things that aren't assets, you're probably wasting your money, right? We have to manage the reality of the finances of it. But I think this notion that I'll do that once I get there is actually a little bit ass backwards.
Today's guest was a pro Major League Baseball pitcher who has gone on to be a profound writer and speaker. He's authored 5 books, including We Are All in This Together. He speaks and he writes about appreciation, authenticity, taking action, really just how to bring the best version of you to everything you do. And he does it better than anyone else. So please help me in welcoming to the We Do Hard Things podcast, Mike Robbins. You listed on your site that you're a contributor to the book 30 Things to Do When You Turn 30, but yes. I couldn't find your tip. What was your suggestion that you have to do before you turn 30?
Oh, gosh. Well, you know, I'm 46 now, and I
read old.
I know. Well, thank you. I appreciate it. I want to say I contributed to that book. I was probably in my early 30s, mid 30s when they asked me. And it was more just essays, you know, from different people, different thought leaders on what are things to do when you turn 30. And my recollection of what I wrote is, you know, just about really embracing who you are and kind of going deeper. You know, my memory 16 years ago of turning 30 was that I was scared and that's okay. I didn't feel old, but I wasn't feeling quite young anymore in the same way. And I think when we get to different milestones, like I think every birthday with a zero on it is a big time for us to reflect. And you know, my advice to people turning 30, especially, is just like you are entering into a new phase of life, but it's an exciting one. And it's about, you know, going deeper into who you are. I think that's true by the way, when we turn 40, I'm not 50 yet. My wife just turned 50, but you know, I think each decade, you know, there's sort of different lessons and different themes. But for me, you know, turning 30 and for people turning 30, I do think it's a time to start to, you know, if you haven't already really started to think of yourself as an adult, probably a good time to do that and then start to think of what kind of adult am I and do I really want to be?
And the reason I asked that because it stuck out at me is I never struggled with 30. I struggled with 25.
Okay.
I struggled with 35. I imagine, you know, when I turn 45, I'll struggle with that, let's say, but right. I really don't know. But did you find that that you've had these moments of reflection, you know, at 30, at 40, at whatever it is that you're, you know, you're 46 now. So,
right.
And how is that different? Where I'm going with this was, how is that reflection different than the work that you do? Because you're an author and you're a speaker. And I imagine you spend a lot of your time in research and reflection and contemplation and stringing all these things together. Is there a difference?
Well, I mean, I think for me personally, you know, 40 was actually really cool. I remember 30 being an interesting one. I had met my wife, Michelle. We've been together for 20 years now, and we were getting pretty serious. So, but what's interesting, I think different numbers and different milestones mean different things to people. Actually, turning 46, I'm about to be 47 in February, but turning 46 was a big one for me. In kind of a sad way, but also in kind of a big way, because my sister passed away when she was 45 and she's 4 years older than me. And a very dear friend and mentor of mine a number of years ago passed away when he was 45. He was 12, almost 13 years older than me. And so there was something about being 45 for me. There was that part of, oh, wow, this is the same year that Richard died. This is the same year that Lori died. And so for me to turn 46 at the beginning of 2020, before we went into the pandemic, and but it was a really big thing for me to just realize, oh my gosh, I hadn't realized how much I'd actually been holding my breath a lot of the year when I was 45, I think because of those experiences. So, and I share that from the standpoint of my work is really about authenticity. And I do a lot of work with people and with teams and with leaders and with entrepreneurs and different business topics, if you will, but it's about getting underneath kind of what's real and what's true for us. And so I think, you know, birthdays and big milestone birthdays, as well as, you know, the new year and different times that are sort of arbitrary moments in time in and of themselves, they don't really mean that much, but I think we bring meaning to them, and they're times for us to stop and reflect and really ask some of those deeper questions. So I like to use those times myself to do that. And I think if anybody finds themselves struggling with any particular milestone, you know, anniversaries of things can be exciting, but they can also be sad. And for anybody who's dealt with grief, you know, or even if you haven't dealt actively with grief, I think that the process of aging in life is filled with celebration and grief. I know that's been my experience as a parent. Our girls are 14 and 12, and I both love and hate that function on Facebook where they show the memories from, you know, last year or 5 years. It's like a photo popped up just recently of my girls from 8 years ago, and I simultaneously was like, oh my gosh, they're so cute. And then like, oh my gosh, they're nothing like that anymore. And that time of my life is now gone forever.
Can I just, can I share? So I have my oldest is 14, and then I have a 12-year-old who's a boy, and then I have two more who are younger.
Oh, wow.
But
you're a professional, man. We got two, you got four. But
whatever, that aside. But I literally had this same thought that you just shared. I had the same thought on Saturday night, I think it was, or it was the other night. My 12-year-old son, you know, he's going through some tough things, and he's at this stage, and you know, he's not living up maybe to the responsibilities we set for him. You know, we say take out the garbage, and 2 days later the garbage still isn't out. And why do we have to chase you and all this stuff?
Right.
And so we've been on him and on him and on him. But I had this realization that, you know, those Facebook memories, he came to say goodnight to me, and he lay down in bed, and I thought, this is the same boy that at four or five, I would tickle and I would play with and I would love. And it's the same boy. And so I reached over to him and I treated him completely like he was a 4-year-old, and I started tickling him and being silly with him and all this stuff. We really connected for a minute there, because I was like, you know, he's older. My expectations have changed, but it's the same kid there. And so I do get this, like, the reason why I want to start with time is I do get this issue myself, and I think other people do, where we get sentimental about the past. We get fearful about the future.
Sure.
And that leaves us kind of stuck.
Yeah. Well, I think, and in our relationship with time, is a really interesting thing. You know, we were just rewatching the show, The Good Place. I don't know if you ever watched it. It's a really funny, interesting show. And
I'm watching it right now with my 14-year-old.
Oh my goodness. Well, okay. This won't be a spoiler. Hopefully not.
There's
a moment, right, in Kristen Bell, who we just adore at our house, and everybody who's in that show. But basically she says something towards the end of the show about, like, all humans are a little sad because they know they're going to die. And when I thought about that, like, that's pretty profound when you really think about it. And I think in some ways it's something that we don't tend to talk about directly, but is the reality. Even, you know, you start with the question about birthdays or milestone birthdays. It's like this whole notion of aging and of birthdays, and and you get, you know, cards and you're over the hill and there's this and that, but it is that sense, the reality of the passage of time. And that ultimately, you know, we all know where this ends. You know, I wrote actually one of the chapters in one of my books, my third book, which is called Nothing Changes Until You Do, came out a number of years back. There's an essay in there about when my mom was sick and she was dying. She had cancer and she was dying. And I was with her at the home that I grew up in Oakland, California. And I was staying with her. And it was really hard to be there for me for a lot of reasons, because she was sick, and I didn't love that home. It was old and falling apart, and I had some issues just with the house itself. And while I did have lots of positive memories as a kid with my mom being sick, there was just a lot going on. And I go out for a run in the morning after I'd spent the night with my mother, and I'm literally running up and down the hills where I used to ride my bike and my big wheel as a kid, and all these memories are flooding back to me, and I'm super emotional because my mom's sick. And I start to have this thought, like, I wonder what it's like for my mom knowing that she's going to die, because it was abundantly clear. And she was, you know, stage 4 lung cancer. Like, and then as I'm running and having this thought in my head, I literally stopped, physically stopped running, and went, wait a minute, I know I'm going to die. I mean, it's not like imminent, like it seems to be for my mom, but the truth is, like, I don't really live like that. And the whole point of that essay that I wrote, and ultimately when I share that, even not to be melodramatic about it, but it's like, what if we lived our lives a little more aware of our own deaths? Because then again, those little moments in the bed with your son or just sitting around, and even during when times are tough, as they've been for a lot of us for the last year, if not more so for other reasons, can we stop and just have those moments and realize, you know what? This moment, even if it's in the middle of something difficult and challenging, will be something that I reminisce about at some point. And it's hard for us to have that awareness or that mindset in the moment. And that's why, again, that Facebook function, which again, I both love and hate, it does remind me that, oh, I can't get those moments back. And the sadness that I feel sometimes is, did I fully appreciate that moment while it was happening? Or was I so obsessed with all of the different things that weren't going quite right, or that I was worried about at the time, which sadly is more often than the truth than I like to admit.
Just maybe by nature of the conversation we're having, you know, in the span of the last 10 minutes, you know, you've mentioned the passing of three people close to you.
Yeah.
Have you in your life experienced quite a bit of loss, and, or is this just, you happen to mention the three people who,
well, I mean, I lost my dad when I was 27. I lost my mom when I was 37. I lost my sister when I was 41. Richard Carlson, who wrote the great book, Don't Sweat the Small Stuff, and It's All Small Stuff, was my mentor. He wrote the foreword to my first book, Focus on the Good Stuff, at the end of 2016, 3 weeks before he very suddenly passed away at the age of 45. So those four people, you know, I've had other losses in my life, but those are probably the four most significant. And, you know, they've had a huge impact on me, those people when they were alive, but they're passing. And I would say, you know, my experience with grief, and everyone has their own journey, of course, is that grief, my friend Glennon Doyle likes to say that life can be brutal and beautiful at the same time, or brutiful, which I think is exactly what grief is like, that I have probably learned as much or more from loss and grief as anything. And I don't hold it like tragedy. And do I miss my sister and my parents and Richard? And yeah, of course I do. But I also, you know, again, it is part of life that we don't tend to. And again, when we're even the ages that you and I are, or even in middle age, we don't really talk about it or think about it. It starts to become more real as we get older, or maybe as we have parents or people close to us who do pass away, we're sort of forced to deal with it. But it's like a mentor of mine said to me years ago when I was actually starting my business, he said, Mike, you're living your life as though you're trying to survive it. I said, yeah. So he said, you have to remember something really important. I said, what's that? He said, nobody ever has. I said, what? He said, the mortality rate is holding strong at 100%. Like, you're not getting out of this thing alive. Why are you spending so much time trying to protect yourself? And it was really an important piece of feedback for me at that moment, and continues to be as I move through my own life, my business, my family, and work with all the people that I work with. It's like, can we take what we do seriously, that it's important and it matters, because it does. And at the same time, not take ourselves too seriously, not take life too seriously. It's a hard balance, but I think a really important one.
And so so what does that look like? How are you able to do that?
Well, I think some of it's just talking about it, honestly. I mean, that's been part of my passion over the years, and the books that I've written and the work that I do. Again, it fundamentally comes down to authenticity, because I was always the kind of kid, right? Like growing up in school, and I did pretty well in school and I did pretty well in sports. I was like doing that, but like, I was always the kid that was like, I'm sitting in trigonometry class and, you know, junior year in high school, and they're teaching us some random formula about something. I'm like, why the hell do I need to know this? I want to know how to deal with all of these feelings I have inside of me, or I want to know how come I feel so insecure or sad or excited, or, you know, whatever the feelings are. And growing up, you know, my dad wasn't around. I was raised by a single mom, and I just didn't have a lot of role modeling. And I thought I was crazy. Like I was really good in baseball. I ultimately got a chance to play in college and then play professionally. But I would have an enormous amount of insecurity and fear when I would go play, which I didn't understand, because it was like, I'm good. Shouldn't I be super confident? Like, why am I not confident? And I would look at my teammates and they all looked way more confident than I felt. But that's because we weren't really talking about how we were actually feeling. Like when as I got a little bit older and I started to open up more and I would share some of my own fears and doubts and insecurities, almost always while people, especially guys, would first look at me like I was crazy, then they would sort of look around and go, you feel like that, man? I feel like that. And it would just be this sense of like, oh, I'm not crazy. It's just everyone's lying, or at least not telling the full truth.
They're all puffing up to make sure that no one sees, you know. I remember in grade nine watching, I don't know what it was, a movie about World War One or something. And it was so poignant and so sad and heartbreaking that at the end I was crying, like in class, I was crying.
Yeah.
I remember thanking God that the lights were off and I sat in the back row of the class. Cause you can't be, you know, whatever it is, a 14 or 15 year old boy crying in class. Cause you know, you're watching a World War One movie or something.
Right. I mean, but think how crazy that is. I mean, you know, raising four kids yourself. I mean, we have two girls. And look, we've gotten better, but the way we raise our boys and raise our girls is different. And to some degree, you could argue it probably should be. But I think these notions that we get, especially, I mean, I know that I was definitely given the sort of be a man training. And I didn't even have a man in my house. I just got that from the world. It was like, suck it up, be a man, boys don't cry. And we internalize that stuff to the point where it's like, whoa, this is really unhealthy. And so I think, again, I think about this in the context of a lot of work that I've done with business people and entrepreneurs and people, you know, starting new things or creating a team or a culture. And it's like, well, what are some of the things we need to do in those environments? Well, yeah, we got to get work done and yeah, we got to hold each other accountable. And yeah, we're trying to produce some results, but like we got to create an environment. And I learned this as an athlete too, where people actually care about each other and their space to be human. Because as simple as that sounds, that's huge. Right. And the feeling that we have, and again, now most of us working virtually and not being with each other, it's like, how do you create that sense of trust or that sense of connection or that sense of what we call psychological safety? Meaning I can show up and be myself. I can admit when I'm, you know, scared or when I'm excited or when I'm sad or when I made a mistake or when I want to try something, but I'm not really sure, you know, so much mm-hmm. of, you know, this because of your work and entrepreneurialism and trying something, creating something great, you got to be willing to fail and fail a lot, which is super uncomfortable. And nobody I know likes to fail, but nobody I know who's ever been successful hasn't failed a ton of times along their way to being successful. So it's this weird sort of paradox that we all have to figure out how to navigate. And we don't get a ton of training. We get all kinds of training for how to do stuff. We get very little training for like how to be in the world and how to navigate.
How to feel, how to be, how to think, all of those things.
Yeah. I mean, think about we get more training on how to drive a car than we do on how to parent children. That's insane. But like, that's the world we live in.
Well, you know, it's so funny because, you know, I'm so into this that I have my blind spots are as massive as anyone else. But a little while back, I decided that after many years of thinking it, I was going to start therapy. And I didn't have an anti-therapy thing. I just didn't think I was sick enough to warrant it or whatever.
Right.
But I
right.
thought, you know what, I'll try it for, you know, and it was becoming really apparent that I needed to look into it and whatnot.
Yeah.
But I was just, you know, as I was starting to go into it, I was just uncomfortable and not mm-hmm. sure. And mm-hmm. it wasn't that I was admitting, you know, like now things are maybe a little bit more real than they were before, but for the most part, it was me thinking, well, that's not my problem, right? I'm an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur, like small businesses don't have, of course, cultures are terrible at big, faceless, American numbered companies. Of course, culture is bad at blah, 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 yada, yada, but that doesn't affect small companies
right.
But it's, I mean, imagine in your experience, all organizations, all people groups run into these same challenges.
Absolutely. Well, in some ways, and having run a small business myself for 20 years, even though we have partnered with, you know, the biggest companies in the world, they have their own sets of challenges, you know, whether it's the Googles or the Wells Fargos or the Microsofts or the Charles Schwabs of the world, right? And every small business I've ever worked with, whether it's a solopreneur, whether it's two or three people, and in some cases, and I know this from my own journey of being an entrepreneur and running a small business, is that the cultural issues and the personal issues can be that much more exacerbated because, again, in a big company, if someone's a jerk, they can kind of hide them somewhere. Mm-hmm. If there's a problem, if there's a senior leader with a problem, yeah, that person's organization is going to be impacted. But in a small business, which often is, again, you're running with a friend or a spouse or someone in your family. I mean, these things go really deep. And it's also that, like, I love my work, absolutely, and I've put my heart and soul into it. And there's also issues around boundaries and being healthy. And, you know, I know so many really unhealthy entrepreneurs because, again, we live in a world, and I know you're in Canada and I'm here in the US, but it's this world of sort of, you know, martyrdom, and like we celebrate workaholism and we celebrate people suffering, which is totally bizarre. Imagine celebrating like alcoholism in the same way we celebrate workaholism, right? Or you know, other things that we know to be really detrimental. So I think what happens is with small businesses and with entrepreneurs, there is a real challenge that you may not have the same kind of resource and budget to focus on your culture as, you know, Google does, right? At the same time, if you don't do that, it ends up being a real problem. Because if you're running a company with four people, five people, and someone's not happy, not only they're not going to perform, they're going to leave. And like, you got a four-person company and someone leaves, that's a huge resource that walks out the door that now all of a sudden you have to figure out how to compensate for, versus if you have a 40 person or 400 person or 4,000 or 40,000 person company, you know, you never want to lose top talent.
Well, but and the reason that I mentioned the therapy or in the last question as well is I had to make the decision that it's worth this time, right? If I'm going to spend 2 hours per week doing this, it's worth the time.
Yep.
If I'm going to spend it's private therapy, so it's expensive. If I'm going to spend a lot of money doing it, then it's got to be worth the time. But literally, I had to think, okay, let's add up how much time it might take. Let's say I did it for a year.
Yep.
And let's say it cost $10,000. If this can unlock crazy potential in the future, turn me into the person I need to be, help me break through some things that are holding me back, shine a light on, like in my business, I would spend I would spend $10,000 right now to get all of those things fixed. Like, it would be a no brainer. Like, I can write a check and fix these things. And yet I waited years years before I was like, oh, you know what? It is worth the 1 or 2 hours per week, the whatever it's going to cost over there just to fix me. So that way I can be better for the rest of my life.
Totally. Well, think about it like this. You know, it's funny as you're saying that, what just popped into my head. So I have a friend who, I met a few years ago, who's very well known, very successful, and he's been public about this, so I can share it. But so Blake Mycoskie founded Tom's Shoes, incredibly successful, right? He started the whole sort of one for one idea of, you know, people buy a pair of shoes and then they give away a pair of shoes. So it was this sort of, he became and has become a real leader in the space of social entrepreneurism and have been incredibly successful, right? Now, Blake and I met through an organization called the Hoffman Institute and the Hoffman Process, which is a week-long, super deep, very intensive emotional process that's about personal growth. And he and I met in a course, a follow-up course. And one of the beautiful things about this work is it's really deep stuff. It's about family of origin stuff. It's like, it's sort of therapy on steroids in a way. It's group process work. But one of the things about the course and all their courses is you don't talk about what you do, which is
based on DBT.
It's not. It's actually based on, it was started by a guy, Bob Hoffman, years ago in conjunction with a therapist. And it's just been sort of developed and redesigned over the year. And I've done a lot of personal growth work and I've done a lot of therapy. I've been to a lot of workshops. This is one of the most powerful experiences of my life. And anybody listening, if you're interested, you can just Google Hoffman Institute or Hoffman Process. They do it in Canada and around the world. It's based here in the US. But I'm sharing all of this because Blake, when I found it, so you don't know what anybody does. The whole, whether it's you do the full weekend intensive or, and which is kind of liberating, but also for many of us, I realized my little ego had a hard time not walking, hi, I'm Mike Robbins. I'm the author of, you know, I didn't realize how much I would do that in life or tell people, hey, I used to play pro baseball or hey, I have this consulting business because I do love what I do and I'm proud of it. But it was like, wow, I'm really attached to my identity and people knowing who I am and what I do. So anyway, fast forward to, I meet Blake and realize, And at the end of the weekend when I'm with him, oh, I work at Tom's. And I'm like, oh, what do you do at Tom's? And he's like, oh, well, I'm the founder and the CEO. And I'm like, holy, wow, okay. Wow, that's pretty amazing.
He has an amazing story as well.
He's an incredible story. But the thing that he's done over the years, and he talks very publicly about his experience at Hoffman. And more recently, he was on Tim Ferriss's podcast talking about doing some psychedelics and talking openly about he and his wife splitting up, very personal stuff. But he's made a commitment over the years and is invested in encouraging the people on his team at Tom's to go and do things like the Hoffman process and really invest in themselves. Because what Blake understood as an entrepreneur, growing his business, but also then building a culture, is that the personal is the professional and the professional is the personal. So all the way around to you going to therapy, it's like, if you are willing to invest in yourself and if you can unlock some stuff for yourself personally, it's not only going to make you healthier and happier as a human being. It's the same reason why it's important for you and I and everyone listening to us. Like, we don't just take care of ourselves physically because like we want to look good. I mean, that's part of it, but it's like, oh, I have people counting on me, whether I have kids or employees or what. Like, me taking care of myself is self-care for me, but it's also in support of them. I mean, the idea, nobody would say, okay, you should never sleep and eat terribly and not take care of yourself. That's going to be good and sustainable for you personally, but also for your business. I think the same is true. And the more we can move past the stigma of things like therapy and, oh, this is an indulgence, or I'll do this once I'm successful. I mean, look, we have to manage the reality of the finances of it. But I think this notion that I'll do that once I get there is actually a little bit ass backwards.
Yeah. Yeah. It was my wife and I, you know, like in my story, I've lost a lot of weight in the past. I was never fit or anything else. But you know, those Facebook things that come up and we go, ooh, 4 years ago, we were 50 pounds heavier each. Wow. You know, like, but it was, well, we have four kids, you know, I run a business. I barely get enough sleep. There's no time or energy for that. And so luckily we had our kids when we were younger. It's opened up a bit more breathing room. We have a bit more disposable income, but you've really hit on something that I did not realize I was struggling with. And I don't even know if other people struggled with this or not, but I've spent so many years trying to not find my purpose, because I have a different version of it depending on the season of life. But, you know, I have a purpose. And when someone would say, Mark, what do you want to do? I would always have to say, well, where? Like work Mark, father Mark, husband Mark, personal brand Mark, YouTuber Mark, hosts of a podcast Mark, like which Mark?
Right.
Because
I,
you know, it's a different thing that I'm doing depending on where you're at. And I had all these collision of purpose and nothing meshed. I wasn't doing a thing with all of these different expressions. I was doing five different things with five different expressions. And only this morning in my journal that I wrote down, did I maybe think about, you know, landing on something where I was like, oh, I could bring everything together.
Right.
Have you found in your experience or even with yourself that, I guess first, is this more common than I might think? And how do we go about aligning those? Because it doesn't quite feel right yet.
Well, I can relate personally. And I think a lot of us have that experience of all these different selves of ourself. And then it's like, how do we integrate? I mean, you know, it's been interesting. I saw a meme. This was back, you know, in the throes of the first few months of the pandemic. And it said, basically, it was like a cartoon of a guy and his head's on his desk. And he's like, am I living at work or am I working from home? I don't know the difference. And it was, you know, and look, a lot of entrepreneurs obviously have, and myself included, have worked from home or sort of remotely forever. So, but again, these big corporations and everybody working from home, but this notion of like, oh, there's this work self and then there's this self and they're somehow disconnected. I mean, I think most of us have realized over the last number of years that that's not true. And if nothing else over this last year with all of this craziness, it's become abundantly clear. And so I do think, though, there's a sense, most of us, it's funny, even thinking about the investment, I'm someone who's, even when we were broke, maybe because I struggled, you know, my dad had bipolar disorder, a lot of mental illness in my family. When I was in college, I got suicidally depressed, which scared the bejesus out of me because it was super scary and painful in the moment. But also there was this sense of, oh gosh, I got the family curse, which is literally how it's talked about in my family, on my dad's side of the family. So I was terrified. And for my early 20s, as I was playing, you know, college baseball at Stanford and then playing professionally in the minor leagues with the Kansas City Royals, I ended up getting injured as a pitcher and went through that whole experience. But on top of that, and probably related to it, I was going in and out of some pretty serious depressions. And I just thought, that's my lot in life. I'm just going to have to deal with this. Thankfully, with some really good therapy, but also tapping into doing some deeper personal work, by my mid-20s, even though I was still struggling, baseball career had ended, didn't really know what I wanted to do when I grew up. As I started my business, I actually got to a place where it seemed as though I was able to transform and move through a lot of the things that had me think, oh, I'm just going to be in and out of being depressed for the rest of my life. And while I do have my normal ups and downs like every other human does, you know, 20 plus years later, I haven't been depressed since my mid-20s. That said, what I realized, at least for myself, was if I'm going to stay healthy and well mentally and emotionally, I'm going to need to really focus on some practices to help me. And I'm going to need to get some help and support, like as an ongoing thing.
What are those practices that you tend to lean on?
Well, my meditation practice has been fundamental to me for 25 years since I was in college. I'm not, you know, I struggle with it at times. There are times it's easier and harder, but like my journaling practice, sounds like you journal as well. You know, seeing...
Just started last month.
Okay, it's great. Well, I've been journaling. I carry two journals. One is a journal where I just share anything and everything that's going on in my head, in my mind, all the everything, all the deep down dirty. It's great. It's terrible. It's all of it. I just dump it out as much as I can. And the other journal that I've been keeping for probably 10, 15 years, it started off just as a gratitude journal where I would write down 3 to 5 things every day I was grateful for. In the last couple of years, it has morphed into, I write down 3 things I'm grateful for, and I write down 3 things that I forgive myself for every day. And because there's so many things, because I have a tendency, like many of us do, to be incredibly hard on myself, critical of myself. So that's a practice there. Taking workshops when I can. I mean, now, you know, it's been harder because we don't gather as, you know, but seeing a therapist, working with coaches, working with people, practitioners in different realms. I've just always done that. Even when we were broke and I didn't really have the money to do it, we got creative. My wife, Michelle, and I both, I mean, we met 20 years ago doing personal growth workshops. So like, that's always been a foundation. Where I've actually struggled as an entrepreneur and a business owner over the years is that I'm way more apt, and most entrepreneurs are the other way around. So I acknowledge this is a little weird. I'm way more apt to invest money in my own growth and my own well-being than I am in the business. And what I mean by that is that sometimes what I'll do is like, I like making money. I don't really like spending money, like most of us, right? So when it becomes though, and that's actually gotten in my way at times, because the thing is, you know, and the whole thing about scared money doesn't make money, the kind of thing is like, okay, I'll invest in this. I'll hire this person or this contractor, or we'll invest in this marketing plan or whatever the heck it is. And if it doesn't produce results right away, I'll get pissed. And I'm like, forget it. You know, I'll just do it myself or whatever. And that's been it's not a blind spot because I'm aware of it, but it's been a limitation for me. I meet a lot of entrepreneurs who are happy to invest money in their business because there's a passion about the business. But when it comes to investing in themselves,
feel selfish,
more challenging. But I've always known it intuitively, and I'm not trying to sound all holier than thou about it, but I've always known intuitively, like maybe it's because of my years at training as an athlete. Like if I wasn't healthy, it did not matter how talented I was. It did not matter if I couldn't get out on the field because my arm was sore or because I was out of shape, I wasn't going to be able to compete at the highest level. So I think I've always known at some deep level, like if I don't take care of myself, I'm, you know, given what I do, again, I'm not selling widgets. I'm basically selling myself, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm delivering speeches and writing books and creating content that's me. It's not some external brand or some other product or, right? So, but because of that, it's always like, I got to first and foremost take care of me. Not that I never grappled with the self.
I like that so much. And I'm working through that as well. I mean, I love documentaries that focus on musicians making albums.
Yes.
It's super, super niche. It's super weird, but just watching them work through the process of finding the song and producing it. I love it so much. But
that's cool.
But two stick out in my mind that have always stuck with me. So this isn't music related, but Conan O'Brien, when he was, you know, he was kicked off of NBC, he went and did that tour. He did that live tour and they did the documentary. And there was a moment deep into the tour where he was losing his voice. And he was losing his voice because the team had jammed so much press on him, in his opinion.
Right.
And he said, listen, like, guys, I know that you need to do press to sell tickets and everything, but if I don't take care of this, I'm not getting on stage. If I'm not getting on stage, this whole thing is done. You guys are over. Right. But he was angry about it. And I thought, I remember thinking, like, oh man, like, of course that makes sense that he's a star. He's like, yes, everyone's counting on him. Of course that makes sense. Yes. Or I just watched the Taylor Swift documentary where she has these types of moments as well, where she goes like, listen, like, I know that I am, you are all helping me build this thing that's bigger than me.
Right.
But if I am not good, no one is good.
It's true. Well, and
I've never given myself permission to be able to be that important to myself.
Yes. Well, and because I think we think, I mean, as you're saying that, even I think in my head, oh, well, I'm not Conan O'Brien. I'm not Taylor Swift. Like, maybe if I were the star like that at that level.
Yeah.
But I think that the challenge I could imagine, I don't know what it's like to be Conan O'Brien or Taylor Swift, both of whom I love, by the way, and think are great. I did watch the Taylor Swift doc. I haven't seen the Conan O'Brien one, but I will check it out because I'm a big fan of his. But I think at some level, you know, someone said something to me years ago, a coach that I had, about my business. And this goes back to what we were talking about, though. He said, look, in any business, particularly a small business, what's important to do is invest in the asset or the assets of the business. And he said to me, so Mike, in your business, you are the primary asset. There's other assets, but you're the primary one. So anything that you can do that can invest in the asset and make the asset or assets more valuable, that's worth it. If you're investing in things that aren't assets, you're probably wasting your money, right? And I just thought about that. So again, people listening to us, entrepreneurs in different, you know, industries doing different things, if you think about that, but ultimately at some level, even if you're not in a business where you're the face of it per se, or it's you, like my business is for me, you still are a huge asset if you're the founder or you're still running the business, until you get to a level where it's so big that they have to kick you out and bring in a CEO to run it because you're now crazy and making things worse. That's a problem to have, but a good problem. Most entrepreneurs never get to that place. Investing in yourself, taking care of yourself, is not selfish, even though it can seem like it. And look, I know it's challenging. I mean, many, you've got four kids, I've got two. I mean, we have busy lives. We have lots of responsibilities. But ultimately, even if I think about this in terms of our family, you know, one of the things that Michelle and I have done for years and is make sure that we actually get time away from each other and away from the family. Mm-hmm. And it's been more challenging for my wife than for me on a number of levels, you know, the sort of mom guilt. And, but like I, when our girls were young, I used to kick her out of the house sometimes. Like, just send her to Starbucks or somewhere to just, babe, just go for an hour, 2 hours. Like, don't worry. You don't need to even take your phone. I got it. And as the girls have gotten older and they're not in that same sort of that type of different types of needs when they're teenagers, as you know, but to send Michelle and I will go up to Napa for a couple days on our own, usually around the holidays after Christmas, before New Year's, just for a couple days as like a personal retreat. And, you know, I've done it for years for myself, just for some white space, just to kind of decompress, to come up with new ideas and things. And, but for each of us, we found that it really helps our marriage. It really helps our family, just, you know, and look, we're fortunate that we can do that.
Yeah.
It's obviously more challenging in the moment today that we're in, but to be able to, if you can, and even if you can't do something because the resource isn't there, can you take some time? Can you have some white space? Those are things we all need, that time to breathe. And one of the things I see most entrepreneurs, myself included, struggle with these days with all of this great technology. People listening to us right now are probably on some great device, some smartphone, some amazing thing that you, but that means your business is literally with you in your pocket or your purse every single day, every single moment. We have to learn how to turn it off and unplug from it, which is not the easiest thing to do. And all the years of me trying to manage that, the technology keeps getting better and more invasive, if you will, that it's that much harder to disconnect from it because it's so incredible and there's so many benefits to it. And I love it and I can zone out with it and I can do my business from anywhere. But it's like, I got to remember who's running my life and who's running my business. It's me, not the damn technology.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, when all of this did go down, and I don't like to spend too much time on the podcast talking about it because everybody's talking about it and we're kind of over it. But
yeah,
one thing it actually, you know, I had a huge shock to my system because one thing it did teach me is like, oh, you know, we have 3,000 square feet of office space that I've only been to five times.
Right.
10 months. Right. Oh, I guess I don't really need that. And every business kind of felt that. We already had remote teams. We already work with people around the globe. We already have clients everywhere. But it was like that, I don't have to commute the hour each way. Awesome. But on top of that, like I pulled my phone number, like I pulled our corporate phone number off of our website and everything else. Like, we're a service-based business. Like, people need to call us. They want to call us. I just removed it. And it's like, oh, business still goes on. Right.
Amazing,
like,
isn't it?
You know, like, hey, I always wear a black V-neck shirt, but if you go back and you see me in meetings, I'm in a button up, you know, I'm wearing slacks, which I hated. And I was like, oh, my wife was asking me about wardrobe. And I was like, I don't think I'm ever going back. Like, I think I'm going to Lululemon joggers and whatever I feel like in a hoodie forever in the future. And if people don't like that, fine. But until I realized that I wasn't going to lose everything that I thought I was going to lose by just making these really minor changes that don't mean anything. They felt like the biggest thing in the world back in.
Well, look, I mean, we're creatures of habit, and I don't think usually it's not with malintent, but then when we're forced to not do something, not go into the office, all of a sudden it's like, oh, do we need to? And I think we're learning there are certain things that we can't do virtually. There are certain things we can't recreate. So I do think we're going to realize as we get to the other side of this, oh yeah, we're going to need to gather for those certain kind of conversations when we can.
Yeah.
That said, do I really need to wear this kind of clothes? Do we really need to have this much office space? Do we really need to have a bunch of landline phones, whatever the heck it is? And you go, no, but why were we doing that? Not because we're stupid, but because that's what we always did. And it didn't occur to us that we didn't need to do it until all of a sudden we couldn't do it. And then we start to get, and I think again, without oversimplifying it, because it's very complex, I do think there's so many benefits to being able to look at things differently and being able to assess things. You know, we're still in the midst of this, so we don't know how it all shakes out to some degree. But I think ultimately my hope is with all of the pain and difficulty that everybody's been experiencing, there is some real growth and real opportunity that exists now, which does and will exist on the other side of this. Yeah. Because, you know, the way we were working prior to this, obviously there were certain aspects that weren't working and we either knew it and weren't willing to do anything about it, or we didn't even know it because we were just sort of in the soup and couldn't see it.
Yeah. You know, I was saying to my wife the other day, I was like, this is our World War I, you know, or World War II. I have often thought, you know, how any time anyone tries to tell me that the past was better than the present, I would come down with a list of reasons why we are living in the best time to be alive. Yes. And one of them was always like, we didn't have to go through this multi-year globally disruptive thing.
Right.
Okay. Here we are. But then I go, listen, like, you know, we think back about World War II, 6 years plus, you know, plus everything before and everything after and the millions of people, like 6 years of disruption, and it's not our generation. So we go like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
We're whatever we are into this, like we can survive a lot longer too.
It's true. And you know, my parents are both gone, but they were both born in the 30s. And so, you know, I grew up with hearing stories, they weren't melodramatic about it in a negative way, but like, you know, my dad growing up as a Jew in Connecticut, born in 1933, and living through the Depression and then the war and the impact that that had on him and his parents and his brother in the community. And then my mom, you know, and both my grandfathers fought in World War II, and just hearing them talk about what that was like, or little things like my mom saying, you know, we didn't have toys. We didn't have, there was one pair of roller skates for the whole block and we all just shared them. But again, those types of things. What I've been saying to my girls, I've been saying this also to my team, is pay attention to this right now, because we're all going to be telling this story for the rest of our lives. And the other thing that I like to ask myself and everyone around me as much as possible is, as we tell the story, what's the story we want to tell about how we showed up in the middle of this? Right? Because that's another part of it. Am I going to just have survived it, or whined about it, or complained about it, or, you know, freaked out and hid in the corner because it was so scary? And look, I mean, all of those things are legitimate ways to respond. And there are days when I'm literally and more figuratively under my desk in the fetal position, like, nope, make it stop. But I do think, again, it's just like, wow, we have an opportunity here all of us do if we choose to step into it. Not to minimize.
Do you lean and live in the land of optimism typically? And so this comes naturally to you, or are you more pessimistic, or whomever you, you know, more cynical or whatever it is? And so this is actually at work for you to get to this mindset of like, guys, let's decide how we want to show up today so we can look back proud on how we acted.
That's a great question. You know, I think if I'm really honest, my resting state is more pessimistic.
Okay.
My natural state is more to worry and think about what's wrong and think about how, right? That said, I have done so much work over the years and have built the muscles of optimism so much that it's really easy and authentic for me to shift in that direction. So it's not a put on. I mean, in some ways, you know, it's like, I mean, what do I do for a living? I'm a motivational speaker, right? I mean, so it's like, but I there'll be times I'd call my wife from the road and I'd be tired and weary and kind of cranky. And I'm like, okay, I'm like the depressed motivational speaker today. Like, I don't know how I'm going to do this, but I learned how to be able to generate optimism, authentic optimism, even when I maybe didn't feel it myself, if that makes sense.
How do you do this? I'm yeah,
well, part of it is, I mean, like when I get up, like I think of times being up on stage in the midst of grief, in the midst of exhaustion, like, you know, babies and toddlers at home, in the midst of like, I can barely even put two sentences together. But what I would do is I would sit right before I would go out on stage and imagine, you know, being jet lagged and exhausted and just all the things, or being in the throes of, you know, my sister just died or my mom's dying of cancer. I mean, real things that it's like, and sometimes I would actually share about these things openly if I felt like I could do it without just turning into a puddle on stage and like, you know, scare people and right. But what I would do is I would tap into, first of all, my passion for other human beings and for connecting with other human beings in an authentic and real way, knowing that everyone sitting in that audience, while they may not be experiencing the exact same type of pain or fear or doubt or whatever I was feeling, they're all going through stuff all the time. You know, this is just true. It's the human experience. And then what I would also tap into is my genuine desire to be of service to other human beings. And those things, even if my body is completely exhausted, and even if the circumstances of my life at that particular moment are nothing to celebrate, that's something that I can genuinely get excited about all day, every day, for real. Even if I might be like in tears before I get on stage and in tears afterwards because of my own experience. And it's like the selfish part of doing what I do is that it energizes me and it gets me back in touch with what's most important in my life and why I'm here. So that's, you know, that's always what's driven me in this work for the last 20 years as I've been doing it.
I love this. And the reason I wanted to dig into this is, part of the reason why I decided to start therapy is, you know, a very good friend of mine said, Mark, I think you're bipolar. And I was raised, my stepfather had the manic side of bipolar. He didn't have the depressive side. So I was raised in a household where someone would go through 4, 6, 8 week manic episodes. And I was like, wow, trust me, I am not bipolar. And, you know, but my ups are up and my downs are really down. And So I was thinking, well, maybe I have borderline personality disorder. Like I looked at it, maybe. So I'm going through the assessment now. They, you know, they're not sure what it is or if it's that or whatever it might be. But this affects like not only my confidence in myself, you know, when you're up, we can take on the world. We can That's do right. anything, right?
Well,
when
look
down, it's like, it's so hopeless. But even my neutral is like,
right,
not that confident. And so my content, you know, I will not book people if I'm not up. I will not release content if I'm not up. I will not have the confidence to even declare that this is what you should do if I don't believe in it. And I can't believe in it because I can't believe in myself if I'm not up.
Right.
So when you are in those moments, do you just live by the schedule and it was booked 3 months ago, so you got to do it either way? Or
well, I think sometimes what I try to do, even in this conversation, it's like bring in what's real and true in the moment, right? Because again, my work is about not just like, I haven't just written books about authenticity and vulnerability, although I have, like that's how I try to actually live my life. So bring it in. And at the same time, I think there is a way to generate positive energy authentically, just like there's a way to generate physical energy. I mean, one of the things I learned as an athlete, so I was good at baseball. I was okay at basketball, but I played basketball all the way through high school. And I'm actually really glad that I played basketball, because I learned about how, like, I wasn't the best player on the team or anywhere close. So I learned a bit about what's it like to sit on the bench, what's it like to really struggle at something. I didn't realize that was what I was learning, but I was learning that. And I also could remember one of the things that I loved about basketball, but I also hated, was like late in the game, if I was fortunate enough to play most of the game, by the fourth quarter, I would usually be physically exhausted, like just spent. Like I would rather just fall down on the side and take a nap. My body's tired. But there was some other gear that it wasn't personal to me, that I have, that we have as human beings, that even after going up for three rebounds in a row, which jumping when you're really tired is exhausting, and then the guy steals the ball and you have to run back on defense, and somehow I would come up with enough energy, especially if the game was close and it really mattered, that I would get my ass back on defense and get in front of that guy, even though my mind was saying, stop, you're in pain, or this is, you're too tired. My body had some other capacity to do that.
Yeah.
And that's something that I loved. And in any physical activity that any of us do, when you can push past the limit of what you think is possible, there's something really powerful about that. And so to me, I think of myself still in that athlete mode, in terms of, again, I got to be careful, because the dark side of it is I can overwork myself. I can just keep going and going and going and not taking care of myself, as we were talking about earlier. But that ability to realize, like, there is positive energy within me. My job is to tap into it and bring it forth. And you know, the thing about the bipolar thing, it's funny, you know, my wife Michelle jokes that she wants to get me a t-shirt that says mania is my superpower, right? Which is, it can be dangerous, as you and I know.
That's like a quote. I was like, I love Manic Mark. Like yeah, I love that guy.
Exactly.
Is there a way that I could be that guy more often?
Well, the thing is, but I think there's a way to do it with, you know, Michelle calls it, for me, what she says to me is that on a scale from 0 to 10, I'm sometimes a 12, right? Which is, and she's like, and given what I do, that I get up on stage or I'm talking to people, or now even on Zoom, by the way, when I'm doing, especially I'll be doing these presentations, and you can probably relate to this, there'll be 100 people or 1,000 people or 10,000 people. And all I'm doing is just staring at the little green dot on my Mac. And it's like, how the heck am I supposed to generate enough energy to engage when I can't see them, I can't feel them? Like, I've been doing this for 20 years, and all the things that I learned how to do to communicate and connect has been disrupted. But again, back to the 12 thing, it's like there are things that I do in life with my business and in general where it absolutely takes a 12. However, as Michelle likes to remind me, there are moments when I need to dial it down to a 7 or a 3 in order to really connect with her or the girls or what's going on. And so again, this goes back to the conversation we've been having the whole time. It's like you going to therapy, me going to therapy, us doing our inner work so that we can calibrate ourselves is not simply just for our own well-being, which it is first and foremost. It's not simply just for the benefit of our family and the people we love, which it is. It's also for the effectiveness of our business and everything that we do. Because again, your blind spots, just like mine, my dark sides, just like yours, they come out, especially on the people closest to us. And for entrepreneurs, our families are super important, but our businesses and the people we work with are an extension of our family, especially if we're running a small business. I mean, the larger the business, the less intimate the relationships are going to be. That doesn't mean they're not important, but most entrepreneurs I've talked to, again, they're running businesses with a handful of people. Therefore, their bad mood, their, you know, head stuck up there, you know what, is a problem for everyone around them and specifically for the business.
I love it, man. I this hour has flown by, like, seriously. I've enjoyed speaking with you so much. I feel such a kinship to what you've been through. Although I will admit, I'm not a sporty sport person. So no baseball for me, but
gotcha.
I guess just where I want to end with is, you know, when I did look through your all of your books, and I could talk to you for hours about each one. I mean, obviously Be Yourself, you know, Everyone Else Is Already Taken. That was a title that really struck me because of the things I'm dealing with. But I guess the last question I have is, as a professional writer, as a thought leader, as someone people turn to, how were you ever challenged with the moment where you're taking all of your life experience and everything you've heard, everything you've witnessed, and everything you've learned, and you're deciding that you're going to package it up into a book, you're going to package it up into something professional? And that's the point where I feel, and if you're the authenticity guy, that's the point where I feel like it becomes extremely unauthentic, inauthentic. Yeah. That's when someone goes, well, I have a framework for this because it's a four-step process. And I go, okay, cool. Your framework is just like this other framework. I mean, you use a different analogy, you know, you use a different word, you have to use a different, like, how did you get from, or how did you grow into the comfortableness, the confidence to be able to say, this is my package. This is what I'm selling. This is what I have. This is what I know. Without one, feeling like it's just like what everyone else does, or two, losing the authenticity.
Yeah. Well, look, I think it's a really good question, and I've struggled with it over the years. Even five books in, I'm not sure that I've actually fully broken through that. You know, I remember talking to one of my mentors, is a wonderful author, spiritual teacher named Dan Millman, who wrote a great book called Way of the Peaceful Warrior. He's written a bunch of fantastic books. And I met with Dan, went 20 years ago when I was first starting my business. And I said to him, look, I have all these ideas, I have all this passion, but every time I sit down to think of writing anything, either nothing comes, or whatever comes feels like it's just borrowed from someone else. Like it's nothing new, nothing unique. And he said to me, he said, Mike, I think everybody who does this kind of work, if you end up doing this, feels that way. So you're not alone. He said, but here's what I believe. He said, Mike, I believe that there's one light and there's many lamps. So your job is to just be the brightest version of yourself that you can possibly be. And even if you go out in the world and you say exactly the same thing that I say, even if you steal it from me, literally, people are going to resonate with you and they may not resonate with me, for we can't ever figure out why that is. But when he said that to me, there was something that kind of relaxed in me a little bit. And I realized, okay, my job again is to keep doing my work, as we've been talking about, and show up and share whatever story or whatever idea or whatever framework I think is most important at that moment, whether it's here on this podcast with you, whether it's as I've sat down to write all of my five books and any other books that I write. And the truth is, every time I read something that I've written from the past, especially the further back I go, there's a little cringe factor of like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I said it like that, or I wouldn't say it like that now. But I'm proud of that younger version of myself that had the courage to realize I'm not perfect. I got all my own issues and challenges, but I'm going to put myself out there in this way right now and trust that this is the most authentic thing for me to say right now until the next authentic thing for me to say, if that makes sense. And every time I sit down to write a book, especially, there's a part of me that thinks, oh gosh, who am I to write a book, or who cares, or what do I have to say, or why is it important? And that to me, by the way, is the hardest part of creating anything. The creation itself isn't usually that hard. It's the dealing with ourselves in the process. And what I try to do, and one of my techniques, is to bring some of that into the process itself, speak to it, write about it, because what I've learned is it helps me move past it. And most people, just like you and I talking the way we're talking, the more personal, the more universal, most people can go, oh, I feel like that too, or I can relate to that too. And it then ends up benefiting the process, even if what I'm doing or what any of us are doing is attempting to try to give advice or wisdom to people, so to speak, about ways to live or ways to operate or ways to do business. I think sharing our humanity and our process in the process makes it more real and makes it more accessible.
Okay. There was so much that I related to in connecting with Mike. I loved that conversation. Three key takeaways for me. Number one, we need to fully appreciate each moment of our life and not be so caught up in and focused in what's not going right. Number two, pay attention to the time that you're living right now. How will you want to tell the story of how you showed up in those hard moments? And number three, there's only one light and many lamps. So it's our job to be the brightest version of ourselves. I love that. Remember, those of us who have something to prove, we can show the world and we can show ourselves that we have what it takes to make it happen. But you have to think big, you've got to be bold, and you must say yes. If you're ready for more inspiration, you have got to hear the story of how this man went from being homeless to being a multimillionaire, and it was not easy. Click on the link right over there.
I think habits are inherent, but choices are chosen. I did have to make the initial choice, which was the, yes, I'm going to do this, but I did regress several times.